Maybe we'll start in about 3 minutes, I guess. Give everybody about 3 minutes to log in. This is where in-person meetings are better because then you can chat. You don't feel like everyone's staring at you. Should we get started? 503. Hopefully we'll have some people joining a little bit late, but for everybody who's here, welcome everyone. And thank you so much for taking time to log in for our session today. I would be remiss not to acknowledge how difficult the current time is for our faculty, for our learners, and for our patients. So thank you for prioritizing this important topic. There is no argument that diverse healthcare teams provide better patient care, promote innovation, and create stronger, more inclusive work environments, which of course is important for many aspects. And we are very fortunate to have Jason Murray and Shirley Lay joining us today to discuss increasing diversity amongst our surgical faculty, why representation is important, and how unpacking the traditional hiring process can increase representation. A few housekeeping notes before Najib and I introduce the speakers today. Your camera and audio will be off. Please feel free to add comments or questions in the chat throughout the presentation. Comments and questions will be addressed in the last 20, 25 minutes of the presentation today. And if you prefer to ask your questions in person or vocally as opposed to in the chat, please raise your virtual hand during the Q&A session and you'll be unmuted to ask your question. Jason Murray, one of our speakers today, is the current president and managing partner of BIPOC Executive Search. Prior to founding BIPOC Executive Search Incorporated, he worked in the consulting division of Deloitte & Touche as a human capital and strategy and operations supervisor, where he provided organizational management and HR services and was a respected voice around matters of equity, diversity, and inclusion and increasing representation throughout the organization. Jason has a community-facing orientation and has done work with a number of organizations that have deep and abiding commitment to representation in the workforce. He's also a U of T graduate and attained his honor Bachelor of Arts here, and also holds a master's degree in management from Boston University. We are honored to have Jason share some of his wisdom and expertise today, and we look as we look to increase our diversity in our faculty and change our current search and selection committee strategies to reflect this. And Najib will introduce our other speaker. You're on mute.
I was just trying to kill a bit of time until we get more people up. Hello, everyone, and welcome. I'm happy to introduce Shirley Lay. Shirley is a social justice-informed psychologist originally in Oregon, USA, in the States, who is committed to bringing racial justice to the forefront of all healing, consultation, and educational endeavors. For the past several years, she has worked in higher education settings in the United States, providing expertise on equity, diversity, and inclusion-related matters. She holds a Master's of Education degree in Counseling Psychology from Ontario Institute for Studies in Education at the University of Toronto, and a Doctor of Clinical Psychology. Shirley has a personal investment in supporting industries that are committed to dismantling oppressive structural and systemic practices that disadvantage racialized communities. Her philosophy to the work is informed by her political identity as a woman of color, critical race and liberation theories, and community-centered healing practices. And to facilitate the structural changes that are needed to sustain diverse and inclusive work environments, she forges relationships by way of educating, programming, consulting, or consultation work, and community-based healing events with people across disciplines, inviting them to become allies in creating environments that allow racialized peoples to affirm their potential and to realize their inherent worth. Laura, I think we're going to start with Jason, I guess.
I think we'll let them take it away, if it's okay, with both Shirley and Jason. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Najeeb and Laura, for such humbling and flattering introductions. Jason and I are feeling extremely privileged to be with you all today. And we also recognize some of the personal sacrifices that you all have had to make in order to ensure that your patients are cared for. We want to recognize that all of you are probably living with quite a bit of baggage, of emotional distress, also stressors that you've been having to put aside in order to prioritize your work. So on behalf of Jason and I and our firm, we thank you for being here today. We too have some housekeeping items that we wanted to share. While we cannot guarantee perfect creation of a perfect safe space for you all, we will try our best to make it as safe of a space as possible so that you all can learn and ask questions and feel comfortable doing so. This isn't a space to shame or to provoke guilt, and the contents are not shared with you to incite trauma. Please listen, not to just to your bodies, but to your minds and souls in terms of how you're responding to today's content. If it does become overwhelming too much, please feel free to take a break and to leave the space. And whenever you're ready, you're always welcome to come back. Now, a lot of the approaches that we're going to be sharing today will go against convention. That is the exact purpose of our conversation today, to decenter dominant practices and perspectives. And so it's going to require some openness to learning, and it's going to stir up feelings of discomfort because a lot of this may be unfamiliar or requires you to put aside your own assumptions. All of that is welcome today. All of that is welcome. Now, in regards to the number of topics that we're going to be covering, there's quite a bit of it. We don't expect everyone to get everything today. If there's only one piece of item that you do take away, that's great. At the end, like Laura had mentioned, we will be having a Q&A, so that will be a chance to ask them any pressing questions. And if there is one or a couple things that you decide to take away and implement into your practice, please reference our work, please cite us, please give us a shout out, and please lift up our voices and recognizing the work that we share with you today. We'll be speaking for approximately 30 to 40 minutes, and then at the end, Q&A.
Thank you so much for that, Shirley, and thank you, Laura, for going over my background and experience. I won't spend too much time given the fact that you've already done so, but again, my name is Jason Murray. I'm president, founder, and managing partner here at BIPOC Executive Search. I'm really pleased to be able to put together a multidisciplinary search firm, so not just focused on the talent acquisition side of what we do, but one that also does equity, diversity, and inclusion audits, workshops like the one that we're in right now, and so on and so forth. Have a lot of experience doing search, of course, but consultancy as well, such as at Deloitte, one of the big fours. So I'll turn it over to Shirley for a brief introduction, and then she will take it away from there as well.
So Shirley Lay here again, she, her pronouns. Like Najeeb had already mentioned, I have a social justice background and it informs all my work, including consulting work here at BIPOC Executive Search. My search experience have mostly been focused in higher education and nonprofit sector. Okay, so I want to offer a bit of framing before we go into this first slide. Otherwise, things listed on this page isn't going to make much sense. So in our culture, our standard of humanness, or those who we consider have their rights to be protected by law, are those who are cisgender, right? How you feel with respect to your gender identity matches what you look like on the outside, matches with how others perceive you. Right, those who are straight, as opposed to those people who are gay or lesbian identifying, those who are questioning, those who are bi, those who are asexual. Also another standard are those who have European ancestry, okay? Those who are able-bodied, and those who are upper middle class and male identifying as well. And so this is the standard by which all people are measured with respect to their humanness. Right, with respect to their ability to have their rights and needs protected by law. And the further you are from these identities, the more marginalized you become, the less represented you are in this culture. So for instance, women were not allowed to teach in a university or a college setting until 1912. They were not allowed to vote until 1916, and just with only these three provinces. The last province to allow the right for enfranchisement was in Quebec in 1940. And women were not allowed to be in office in Canadian Parliament until 1919, and weren't really deemed as persons under the British Privy Council until 1929, and could even be laid off up until 1978 if you were found out that you were pregnant. With respect to members of the LGBTQ plus or queer community, they could have been fired from jobs if they were found out they were part of the queer identifying community. And the federal government's gay purge from the 1950s to the 1980s serves as an example. Aboriginal peoples, they were not allowed to vote in federal elections until 1960. I don't know if people are aware of Bob Joseph's work. He wrote in a brilliant book called 21 Things You May Need to Know About the Indian Act. And I would strongly recommend this book to be part of your library, because it really informs us as to some of the marginalization, the systemic, legalized, institutionalized marginalizations that Indigenous peoples continue to face in all areas of life. With regard to Black people, they were once excluded from machine work during the Industrial Revolution and service work when clerical settings began to emerge. There's also a history of exclusion of Black folks from Canadian medical schools between 1918 to 1965. And these dates are not too far off in our past. So what are we trying to disrupt here? Jason and I have listed several areas of disruption that we invite people to think about and to consider. The first is how leadership is perceived. It's often subconscious, right? It's reactive. We don't intentionally think about it. It's often steeped in colonialism and systemic power, right? The practice of colonizing is to enter, to take, and then implement your own cultural practices, whichever piece of land or resource that you have taken. So if you think about leadership, and you think about and you uphold an image of the prototype of a leader, right? What is your cookie cutter of an ideal leader? Does this person look like Jason and I? With respect to qualities of leadership, we often look for people who value competitiveness versus cooperation. We value people who maintain power in the hands of a few, right? And we often hide our power behind titles as well, so that we can exclude certain people from participating in certain jobs. We value logic over emotion, and we value high power distance, as opposed to more egalitarian decision makings. And while these cultural values are upheld by prominent individuals in our culture, it is not upheld by every single person, especially for those who come from different cultural backgrounds. With regards to the notion of merit and years of experience, the systemic constructions of what's considered the best, we often equate years of experience or years of lived life to years of experience. And so Jacinda Ardern, she's the Prime Minister of New Zealand, she offers a great example of how she has debunked the myth that one needs to have years of lived experience in order to occupy a very prominent role in parliament, in government. She was appointed to the PM status at 37 of age. And we've seen time and time again during the pandemic how wonderfully, how capably she had done in order to control the pandemic at a very early stage. With respect to the idea of merit, I often call this the hardworking lead to success myth. We often prefer this way of thinking because we live in a really individualistic culture, right? We think that everyone should be responsible for themselves, that we should subscribe to this just world belief, right? This belief of you deserve what you sow, right? And that problems are internalized, are internal to you. And this kind of belief, right, this belief of meritocracy gives us a sense of meaning, of control over our situation, our lives. To give you an analogy, right, I want to let you know that not everybody starts at the same place when we're saying that we're in a race for something, right? Know that if you start from a certain position in a particular race, there are other people who start way further back than you. There are people who are entering this race carrying weights and boulders on their shoulders. And there's other people who you think may be participating in the same race, but their race is marked by roadblocks, stop signs, potholes, right? There are these many challenges that they have to face in order to get to where you might be today, right? So our challenge is for you to debunk this myth of meritocracy, to debunk the myth that if a person doesn't achieve where they need to be achieved today, that is because of personal deficiencies. Really start to think about systems that they're in that disadvantages them. The next idea is that some people think that by increasing representation, it means that we're going to replace people. We're going to supplant people. And this way of thinking is really a colonized way of thinking because it's a thinking based on scarcity, right? So it's either you or me. Another variation of this is saying things like, okay, we've already met our quota for the number of women or female identifying individuals. We met our quota for a BIPOC individual or person with disabilities. And so we don't need any more. Again, this is scarcity type of thinking. And if every institution, every organization can think big, right? Can think like, for example, Amazon, who really thinks about how do we extend our reach beyond North America and just expand into the world. How one can achieve that is through inclusion and inclusion of more diverse underrepresented voices. We have a lot of big problems in our culture, and we need as many voices, as many perspectives as possible. And it is those who often live in the margins that can bring solutions to the table because they've done so much observing. They've seen and understood what the problems are. And so oftentimes they have the solutions more so than individuals who are at the forefront or at the leadership role. And remember, it's about making additions to the team. You're not replacing anyone. Sometimes when we do searches for board of directors, we'll hear things like, in our board of directors policies, we can only allow for 10 individuals to be on the board. And so given that, you know, we have everyone, we can't add additional members. Sometimes you might say things like, well, why don't you change those policies? Who set those policies in the first place? Why was it set? And does it still serve you nowadays? Lastly, our challenge to you is to expand your perception of what leadership means to you. Going back to my first point of we often have cookie cutter models of what we think a strong leader should look like. But here's one example of the Black Lives Movement. We have individuals like Alicia Garza, Patrice Coolers, and also Opal Tometi, who created this huge movement that impacts all of our lives today. And we can make an assumption that they probably didn't have million-dollar budgets. They didn't have tons of human capital or resources. They are often pushed back against. They're often met with resistance. And yet there's such ingenuity, there's such innovation and creativity in terms of spreading the movement, spreading the cause, and rallying people right into their tribes. So we want to invite you to think expansively with respect to what leadership could mean. Okay, so we can't speak for all the nations around the world, but if Canada was truly a democracy, we cannot tolerate discrimination towards equity-seeking groups. And we can't say that our country is fully democratic and expect equity-seeking groups to feel this. We need to ensure that we're taking action, right? We need to move beyond the multicultural rhetoric to create true inclusion. And by that, I mean, it requires one to really reflect on the privileges that they hold, understand that they need to share space, right? There are moments where you need to take a step back and reflect and lift voices that are often not brought to the table, right? So again, moving beyond multiculturalism, which is tolerance, which is acceptance, and then true inclusion is when you reflect on yourself, thinking about how you might have contributed to someone else's marginalization, taking a step back and really using your own social capital, your own network to lift up the voices who are often never heard. And in this way, it really helps us within leadership teams to be held accountable. Because when you have more voices represented, you have people asking questions, challenging the status quo, offering different perspectives. And it's a great way to keep leadership in check, to ensure that you are not exploiting, to ensure that you're not minimizing or further harming certain groups. So this last point regarding creation of a superhero group, recently I watched a Justice League, the 4-hour Justice League movie, and thinking about all the characters that play into Justice League, we don't have 5 Batmans, we don't have 5 Superwomen, and we don't have 5 Flashes. And the reason why we don't do that is because it would be really boring to hear them dialogue with one another and then agree and not make any innovative ideas or change. So when you think about creating your team, really think about what superheroes, what superstars you need to bring in order to diversify your group so that you have the greatest chances of meeting the demands of some of the social problems that we're experiencing today. There is no way that we can solve social problems by doing the same thing over and over and over again. We need to bring in people from the margins, people who've always been watching but never got a voice to speak. Bring those folks in, have them contribute, share the ideas. In that way, then we can truly have a collaborative approach in bringing innovative solutions to daily problems.
Thanks so much for all of that, Shirley. So the slide that we just went over really tells you the what and really tells you the why. And now we want to talk a little bit more about the how. And so as an executive search firm, obviously we go to market representing all sorts of companies and use various strategies to identify individuals, assess them alongside our clients, and then also to making sure that we can actually land them. This is a seminal moment right now where a number of organizations are having the same conversations about wanting to attract people from underrepresented groups. So here are some things that you really should keep in mind if you are ever leading a search or a part of a committee. So obviously there's information that goes into the public domain, advertisements, position profiles. Obviously we can go through advertisements and position profiles and making sure that they're very accessible in terms of language. But one of the things that we really always stress to our clients is that you want to make sure that your advertisements and position profiles are culturally filled. You want to give people a sense of your values, your principles. You want to give them a sense of what's topical within the organization. It will really make people feel like they belong. So again, culturally filled advertisements and culturally filled profiles are definitely something that people need to be putting more and more into these documents, as opposed to the traditional pieces, which can often come across as quite trite and bullet point form, which doesn't necessarily make people feel like they're going to gravitate towards your organization and your work. Also too, in terms of the accessible piece, are you presenting the opportunity in a way that is truly accessible? So what we mean by that is, you know, there are certain strategies that organizations will make use of that are very dated now. So it's, you know, putting together 300 texts and then putting it in a paper or just posting it to a few different venues. We really, really encourage our clients to think about ways to actually broaden your reach. There are communities that often don't feel like they have been intentionally gone into. And so it is really important for organizations to think, how can we really reach those communities? So sometimes it might actually be partnering with organizations that actually do have deep networks in a particular space to be able to say, we want to work with you over time to really make sure that we're doing better in this regard. Another way is to make sure that things are actually in visual form as opposed to just text form. A company like ours, for example, we do a lot of digital ads, not just because it's flashy, but because people actually consume a lot more these days on social media. And even when we're speaking about people who have disabilities, they really feel like they're actually being paid more attention to when there's ways for them to actually learn about opportunities other than you need to have sight in order to read. Trust building during the recruitment process. So oftentimes when organizations are actually doing postings, they are essentially just waiting to see who's going to come to them. And I know that that is the typical way that organizations have gone about their recruitment. Oftentimes there are organizations that will use a third party recruiter or have people in talent acquisition that might do some level of outreach as well. It is really, really important to meet people where they are. So if I can use an example for myself right now, it's objectively verifiable that I am Black. I receive probably, I would say every week, on average, maybe about 3 to 4 overtures every week about people wanting me to consider different opportunities. And if everyone is going to do it the same way, which is here are the hoops you need to jump through, why wouldn't you want to work with us? Where's your 3-page letter and where's your resume or CV? Obviously, it's going to become a scenario where I'm probably going to say none of these organizations are really serious about attracting me. And so therefore, I'm just going to say I'm not going to actually put my hand up for anything. So trust is something that is hard to gain when marginalized groups are approached. And so it's really, really important to you, if you have the benefit of being in conversation with someone, to really listen out for some of what they're saying. There are times, for example, when we are in recruitment mode with our clients, where we will present just a resume on someone as opposed to both the resume and both a resume and a letter, because oftentimes a client can glean from a resume whether or not they feel someone is uniquely suited for the role that they have posted. And so by going that route, it actually says to the candidate, we're not asking you to do too much heavy lifting at the outset. We're asking you to do something that's hopefully quite easy for you to do in terms of providing us with your resume. Oftentimes resumes and CVs, as we know, are relatively up to date. And then from there, going back to the individual with more signals or more cues, we'll often have people say, now I'm ready to invest more time and more effort and more work. With respect to the interviewing process, obviously a very, very important part of the process when people are going through talent acquisition, it is best to give candidates a sense of topics likely to be raised in an interview setting. So this is where equity comes into the picture. So for example, if you have five candidates and they're different archetypes, so you have one who's an internal, you have one who is from a different province, let's say BC, you have one that's from the States, one overseas, you can start to see where the inequities come into play in terms of people are going to show up differently in the interviews. Your internal can already finish your sentences and therefore are already having a leg up. We can obviously look at equities as well in terms of things like race, in terms of gender, in terms of disabilities, et cetera, where some people may not have had opportunities in the same way to be able to strengthen their leadership capabilities, not in all cases, but in some cases that is in fact the case. And so we always say to clients, try not to make your interview a Spanish Inquisition where you're going to torture and examine people with questions and try to catch them flat-footed in an interview to see if they can rise to the occasion on the spot. Rather, it is really good, if possible, to either socialize candidates before an interview about topics that are of interest to you. There are some sectors that are providing candidates with questions verbatim, either the day before or even putting it into these video platforms that we are working on and giving people a chance to digest the question before answering. So really thinking about making the interviews equitable can mean that you're probably going to come up with an outcome that might be different from what you originally were thinking based on taking that approach. So we also write here that, believe it or not, an equitable interview is not asking everyone the same question. That's where other nomenclature comes into place, like equality. But equity is actually thinking what positionality or what lived experience or what circumstance or context really comes with this person's background experience that might mean we need to think through how we actually go about our questions in a different way. So you have to learn enough about candidates to know where you might actually tailor some of your questioning. So on our next slide here, there's a few other areas that we want to continue to talk about with respect to the interview process. So as my bio says, I've done well over 300 searches, probably over 400 now in terms of needing to update my bio. I would say that on average, when doing interviews, 99% of the time, there will be a desire to actually have the committee ask the candidate questions right off the top. But we often encourage our clients to actually switch that around. So actually have candidates ask their questions of you at the top. And the reason why we say that is because, you know, when you're trying to attract people, you really want to make sure that you are creating an environment where they don't feel like right at the bat before they had a chance to learn anything, you're asking them to do all the speaking and you're putting the mic in their face. Also, when you are going through your interview process, sometimes you get to an end of an interview and there's precious minutes at the end, maybe 2-3 minutes for a candidate to ask some of the questions that are on their mind. But when you're trying to attract people, it really is a great strategy to say, let's actually say to the candidate, welcome, thank you so much for considering this important role with our organization. And we know that you're still getting to learn more about us. And here's an opportunity for you to get to learn more about us by starting off with some of the questions in your mind. What that often does as well is it sets the stage for the discussion to follow, but it also really loosens people up. We all know that interviewing is not easy. No matter what people want to say about interviews, it's not a natural way to actually have an exchange. So you are able to really feel like the interview becomes a lot more casual if the candidate can actually hear you do a lot more speaking off the top. It gives them a sense of who you are as opposed to just seeing a face and just seeing a name or just shaking hands in a boardroom and having them start all the talking. Another thing that we often say is good to flip is flip your opening remarks to closing elevator pitch. So oftentimes candidates are asked to think about coming in with some form of a presentation. It's not to say that opening remarks can't be something that is done. Certainly when there are, let's say, 2, sometimes 3 rounds of interviews, you may want to have an opening remarks topic in the second or third interview. But for the first interview, if people are asked to do opening remarks, sometimes what can happen is a candidate who is otherwise exceptional may actually say things in the interview that has you starting to turn off. There's something that happens in interviews quite often where people ask a question and they already know they're listening out for certain answers. And the candidate that's actually able to bring you certain answers is already a candidate that starts to, if you were to be grading them, be more elevated in your mind as opposed to candidates who weren't actually giving the answer that you wanted to hear. And it's the same thing with opening remarks. People sometimes come with opening remarks that a committee will start saying to themselves, that's not really what we wanted to hear. And so therefore I'm starting to shut down. And now the job of the candidate is to recover during the Q&A. If you allow the candidate to start off with asking some of their questions to learn more about you, then go into the Q&A, the elevator pitch now starts to become something that has two aspects to it. The first aspect is what they prepared coming into the interview, but then they can start massaging some of what they are going to actually share with you based on going through a process where A, they had their questions answered, B, they went through a Q&A, and then finally, they can start giving you something that's a bit more tailored in terms of the elevator pitch at the end. Another thing that we want to bring up here in terms of interview questions that will pretty much ask you to be vulnerable and essentially tailor them as you get to self-IDs. So many times when people are going into conversations and, you know, they really are trying to bring a strong EDI lens to the conversations, there may be different people, again, different lived experiences that are a part of your short list of candidates. And so if you have someone who, let's say, is racialized or BIPOC and someone who is non-BIPOC, you probably want to ask questions that are a little bit different when it comes to the whole EDI piece. For BIPOC executive search, for example, everyone is always welcome to apply for roles. So even though we specialize in really making sure that our networks are very, very deep with communities that are underrepresented in leadership, all are welcome to apply. And we have networks of people who are non-BIPOC that we reach out to as well. But everyone should really be thinking that they have responsibility in driving EDI forward. So an example here that you might, in terms of the question that you might ask to racialize candidate is, you know, we acknowledge that we have work to do in the area of equity, diversity, and inclusion. We are listening and we're responding. With the amount that you know about us to date, and this is a safe space to share, where have we been falling short in our efforts to advance EDI? So bringing that vulnerability to the picture is actually something that we would encourage clients to continue doing. For anyone that is being interviewed who is non-BIPOC, so again, looking for people who really are conscious to the fact that all of us really can do our part to contribute to advancing our organizations in this regard, you may ask a question that's a bit different when it's an EDI question, and that might be, we acknowledge that we have work to do in the area of equity, diversity, and inclusion. We are listening and we are responding. Have the events over the past year, which we wish to acknowledge go way back in history, awoken or renewed your sense of allyship? So again, think about your questions in a way that is about equity, not necessarily about sameness. Some questions might be, but some questions you might really want to think through, is there an opportunity here to kind of tailor them somewhat? Go to the next slide now. Here is something that I already shared somewhat, but I will just repeat. So, you know, we have to really make sure that we stop listening for what we want to hear. You know, we are human, we're imperfect. There's a lot that we stand to learn and a lot that we stand to gain by making sure that we are open and we think about things like leadership in the most expansive way. So when interviewing, be careful not to listen out for answers you want to hear. Doing so is a form of bias. And you will miss out on what might be possible for the organization or the portfolio if you don't work with what the candidate is saying. We have been in interviews many a times where we put this right up front for a client. And sometimes they might actually have someone that they weren't necessarily sure about in the paper screen. But when they are actually open and when they are actually thinking about learning from the candidate, it's a marvel to see what they come away with. And we have many examples in the marketplace where people who are in particular jobs that we were helping clients recruit for are doing far better than the company imagined, literally, than the company management. imagined. We have a little quote here that we like to share with people. Leadership shouldn't be about competition or ego or power. It should be about service, which we know is something that is held in high regard with respect to universities, healthcare, et cetera. It should be about seeing how the ball is hit when different people get a turn at bat. And Jacinda Ardern is a really, really good example, as Shirley mentioned in the slide earlier. To be prime minister of a country at 37 is definitely a huge responsibility, and to see the incredible work that has been coming from her leadership really should tell all of us that we really need to be open, listening, and really be thinking about possibilities as opposed to what has happened previous. So we'll go into the next slide here. And this is just a slide that we like to talk to people whenever we are talking about the world of recruitment, talent acquisition, by throwing in some analogies. And so what are we really doing when we're recruiting? We're courting. And there's two different relationships that involves courting. So, you know, one obviously is a romantic relationship, someone that we call our significant other, someone who's our partner in life. And we do know that there could be chapters of what that looks like in some of our lives in terms of different individuals. But then there is, the work relationship. And the difference between the two is that one has a shorter courting period and one has a longer courting period. So from the romantic sense, you know, there are individuals that can be getting to know each other over a long stretch of time before they make a firm commitment. So it can be years and years before that happens. Whereas with recruitment, you're working with a shorter period of time and you're working with a lot of different constraints that may inform the way you go about the process. So some constraints might be a competitive marketplace. Others might be, you know, the portfolio really, really needs the leader yesterday. And so if we don't actually have someone, then we're really going to be in some serious trouble. But we really do try to make it very, very clear that it is important for, even if you're working in a short period of time, for you to infuse tactics in your actual processes that allows you to get to know someone in a way that is about courting as opposed to being transactional. When you are transactional, you are likely going to miss out on gems in terms of individuals that come from communities that are historically underrepresented in leadership. And the more you are able to say that you're going through something that feels more like it's a courting process, that you feel like you're getting to know individual, you really start to think about what they're going to be able to do as a member of your leadership team or as a member of your team overall. So we'll go into now the next phase of our discussion, and that is to say, let's open things up. Obviously, we wanted to make sure that we were capturing as much as possible on a high level, lots and lots more to talk about in terms of this work. So maybe we can open it up in terms of questions, and then Shirley and I are available as well to people offline. If ever anyone wants to even have a phone call, we're more than happy to chat with you about some of what you're up to. So can we open it up and see what questions come to us?
Thank you very much for that presentation. So hopefully if you have a question, you can either put it in the chat or virtually raise your hand and Terry can unmute you. I can get started if there's nobody waiting. I can't really tell if anyone's waiting or not. It's kind of a blind audience here, but one of the examples, Jason, that you mentioned about how to increase diversity of the applicant pool, you talked about the job advertisement or the posting that you create, and you mentioned it should be culturally filled. I don't know if I'm alone or not, but I'm not sure what exactly that means. So if you don't mind giving us an example or a sentence or two, or just a sort of an example of what it means by making a posting culturally filled, that would be really helpful.
Absolutely. So at the outset of a posting, there are times where an organization might just talk about facts, right? So it might be, you know, since 1960, the organization has ABC, this is what we do, things of that nature, as opposed to really making sure that a candidate in reviewing a posting can actually get a real strong sense of values, really get a strong sense of what drives you, get a sense of mission, get a sense of purpose. And so anything along those lines, particularly for individuals who, again, may have been marginalized historically and not represented in leadership roles as much as they perhaps should have been, we'll be able to say, this is an organization that clearly is a place I want to investigate more and potentially be the person in that particular role. So it really comes down to mission, vision, purpose, values, principles. Those things should really be at the forefront of advertisements. Shirley, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
Yeah, for sure. Thanks, Jason. I was also thinking, you know, based on an earlier point I made, whether or not a workplace is competitive or cooperative. What are the power dynamics like? Is it more of a hierarchical one or a flat reporting structure? So giving people a sense of culturally, what does it feel like to be in that space, to live and breathe in that space? And as a you know, BIPOC individual looking over job descriptions, I'm always wondering, am I gonna fit in there? I'm always wondering, do I have a skill set that they know they're missing and that they need that from me? Right? And so that's how I normally scan through job descriptions, you know, just as a candidate or as an applicant myself, thinking about cultural fit and thinking about are my cultural values represented in that organization or institution?
So I think just in the chat, Dr. Fialikoff had asked sort of, are you referring to an ad? And we, I guess in surgery, we the way we advertise a job is or a position for a surgeon, for example, is we would create a job posting, which we usually try to keep fairly short because it's a job posting that may be describing, like, say, we need a new breast surgeon hire, and it would be describing, you know, what kind of surgical role that is. And then usually at the end, we would use our like EDI sort of sentence or insertion. But we're wondering, you know, maybe is there like a succinct way that you can give like a sentence or two that you can describe the fact that in a surgical environment or a medical environment, you would like to promote diversity or inclusion is very important, or how would you word that in a short job posting?
Yeah, I mean, even with something with respect to equity statements, you know, equity statements typically at the bottom, but again, it can be a simple flip, right? Putting it at the top. Sometimes, you know, companies will put a land acknowledgement in. So things that are signaling to communities that these things are on our mind and these things really truly do matter to us. Even the conversation that we're having today, a simple sentence can be, you know, our organization is committed to, you know, continue to be committed to doing our part to, you know, promote equity, diversity, inclusion, dismantle, you know, systemic barriers, which is reflected in our recruitment process. And we are, you know, encouraging applications from X communities. So those are examples. But, you know, when companies talk about mission, vision, et cetera, those things shouldn't be things that people have to look for and find. Right. So, you know, yes, they might be on your website, but people shouldn't have to scan through your website to be able to say what your organization stands for. If you are putting something in the public domain that's specific to a job, it really is important for you to just show up. And if you're trying to attract more diversity, which is, you know, what people are saying they want to do more of, you really should be thinking, okay, these are certain ways that we can go about getting the attention of individuals that perhaps have not been applying as much.
Maybe I have a question, Laura. It's a two-part question. First to Shirley about the background. I think I view the background of the history of discrimination and so on to be very important. But sometimes the question comes up, well, you know, this was in the 60s and the 40s, things have changed. How is that going to impact what I do now in my recruitment? And why do we still kind of talk about these things? That's the first part of the question. And the second part of the question is to Jason about the aspect of the interview process and the questions. There's always been this idea that if you standardize the question, meaning you ask everybody the same question, it's a bit more fair. Yet that's not necessarily always the case in the sense that, for example, in medical school applications or residency applications, people ask like, what extracurricular activities do you do, for example? Clearly, if you come from a lower socioeconomic class, maybe all activity you could do is go to work to pay for your university, right? Tuition. For somebody who's more affluent, could tell you a much more interesting story about how they traveled and did charity work and that, because really they could afford it. So how do you account for that? And how do you not make that perceived, irrespective of what it, whether it is or not, as favoritism reverse as it's viewed sometimes? Because that goes into people saying, well, you're skipping merit for accommodation of another sort. And so those are the two questions.
Thank you, Najib. If it's okay, Jason, I'll take the first one. So great question. We get this one a lot. These things have happened in the past. What does it have to do with us? So if you think about certain marginalized groups, certain racialized groups that haven't been given opportunities in the past, what ends up happening is that those inequities get passed on to future generations. Right. So, for example, my husband's father, so my father-in-law, he's Chinese identifying. And when he came to Canada, he could only apply to certain departments within the university. He actually wanted to be a medical doctor. But at that time in Winnipeg, those who are Asian identifying were not allowed to apply. So what ends up happening is that that gets passed on to future generations. Now his children, my husband, won't get to see somebody who got to achieve their dreams academically and become a doctor, right? And have gotten the mentorship that he had needed in order to maybe implement it in his life, right? So when we don't see people who look like us represented, it says something about our inabilities to get there. It's what we often term a symbolic violence. When there's no representation, it sends a message, even if it's not directly spoken, that we don't belong there and that we don't have a means to get there. Oftentimes, in order to get into leadership roles, it is not just based on merit. Think about how much mentorship each one of us sitting in this room have had to have gotten in order to get to where we are today. Just to even navigate the higher education system is daunting for somebody who doesn't have English as the first language, who's first generation, who comes from a household where they didn't have the finances in order to fund them through schooling. So this kind of impoverished inheritance gets passed on generationally. And this is why we need to go all the way back to see where are the roots of oppression. Otherwise, we don't have context. Otherwise, we go back to the story of meritocracy. This person did not try hard enough in order to get to where all of us are today.
Thanks so much for that, Shirley. And just to go into your second question with respect to the interview process. So people really do need to understand more and more the difference between equal, so equality, and equity, right? So, the questions, when they're the same or when they're even, that is equal. So everyone is getting the same question, but equity needs to start to be considered for a number of reasons, including the great example that you gave as well, Najib, right? So you're speaking about some individuals might be able to answer the extracurricular question with a lot more examples rather than some others who may not necessarily have had the means growing up. To be able to say that they were also exposed to all these wonderful extracurricular activities that they can put into their application. And it's the same thing with, experience. So, we use Jacinda as an example. She's 37 when she became prime minister. If they pretty much said, we want to see 25 years of experience or 20 years of experience where she was 17, right? When 20 years before. And so, if you look at someone who is 60, well, they were already 40 to get, 20 more years of experience by the time they were 60. So you always have to think about the fact that if you want to do it equal, then you're probably not going to see different results. And that is part of the reason why we're not seeing different results, because people are saying, well, you obviously have to ask the questions the exact same way. So, if people want to see different results, and like Shirley said, people started at different points on the race, right? You know, that's why we gave all those examples in one of the slides up front. I mean, women, again, officially started at McGill 1912, someone officially getting tenure in a university. You know, Aboriginal women weren't able to vote until 1960. You know, people started at different places. So when people say, well, we don't see very many, let's say just talk about the world of medical, right? Because we said Black people at one point were told you should actually wash and clean yourself before you touch another person. You know, we do equity, diversity, and inclusion audits where we work with some healthcare institutions where some nurses have said that some of the patients don't want Black nurses to touch them, right? So basically what has happened throughout history is some people have started with a deficit, and in order to be able to catch up, or in order to say different results, or in order to make sure that everyone's bringing their visionary sophistication, because there's a lot of incredible things that have happened when, people who look like myself or Shirley are also able to be around the table, we do have to actually look at the processes we've been doing and say, what needs to change in order to actually have different outcomes, or sometimes the right outcomes, because it's not just about, okay, well, you know, we're trying to hire, let's say, more people of color. Sometimes in just doing the process, you actually say, well, you know what? This is actually the right outcome in the end, based on the fact that we're able to do that equitable approach as opposed to equal.
Hey, Joanna, you have a question?
Yeah, I received this question anonymously through, well, they'd like to remain anonymous, but I received it through Twitter. Someone who's watching wanted to know, they find that this problem, you spoke about it earlier, Jason, this idea that merit is not, it's that we're not replacing anyone, it's accommodating. And in pursuing diversity in hiring, we're not actually replacing anyone, but a lot of people feel personally attacked and they can't seem to wrap their head around that. So we were just wondering, what are some practical strategies for really communicating that concept, especially in medicine, that no one's being replaced, no one's career is under siege, and how do we overcome hoarding, basically, is what they want to know.
Yeah. So, you know, on the topic of, you know, making sure that we are adding and not replacing, you know, when you bring in someone who has not had their voice around the table, what you are doing often right away is you're bringing many individuals in communities to the table as well, right? So, you know, just by saying, okay, well, we have gone through a process that led to, let's say, someone who's from the Indigenous community or someone from, you know, Black community or you name it, you are right away bringing into the conversation and bringing to the organization or association, whatever it might be, individuals that are part of that community, right? Which is part of the reason why it's important. But it really does go back again to the fact that people need to understand that there's a zenith in terms of where companies can go. And if we're constantly saying, okay, well, we're going to have a very limited way of thinking about this, then that means a company is actually stopping itself from continuing to grow. Right? So it's, what is your strategy? Do you just want to say, okay, there's only fixed numbers, or do you want the overall organization to grow? And if so, bringing in new voices means that you grow the cadre within and you grow the periphery in terms of the people that are now a part of the conversation externally, right? So people just have to understand it conceptually, why it's important to make sure that these conversations are happening that way. You know, even when we think about the pandemic, you know, there are organizations that have had to scale back. But, you know, what we find interesting is that there are organizations that are saying, okay, well, we actually do have a budget that we want to put towards, let's say, headcount, and have someone come in as a director for diversity, equity, and inclusion, right? So it's like the organizations can actually look at its strategy and say, how can we add, as opposed to thinking about being narrow-minded or thinking about replacing. So those are some things that we would offer up there, and among others, of course.
I think we have time for one more question, and there's a great question in the Q&A chat box, just about giving the interview questions beforehand as a new concept, because I know usually we don't typically do that. And you had mentioned that was maybe a good idea to level the playing field, because it maybe gives people who have not had the opportunity to illustrate what they're capable of, they may be able to think things through a little bit better. So The question is, do you have a suggestion for discerning those who have genuinely thought about their responses from those who just know how to play to the question?
Absolutely. Seeing how someone prepares, you know, for their interview is going to be a data point, right? So if you feel like someone's reading from something, for example, right away, you're kind of thinking to yourself, okay, I'm not sure this person either A, knows how to present. And when you're a leader, you have to be able to present on the fly often, or you can start to be reading into that. Maybe this person doesn't actually have enough experience, right? As opposed to someone who is just coming to the conversation and still having a conversation with you. Generally, what we do is the second interview, we don't actually prepare people the same way. The second interview, we actually say, now that we had an opportunity to speak to you, we now are going to nuance the questions even more. And so there's no need for you to see anything in advance. Let's just have that casual exchange. But then also references. So if you are giving people an opportunity to think about it before, it's that much easier to actually verify in the reference check that it adds up, as opposed to not actually hearing from them in a way that was thought through and considered. You're not actually getting enough meat. You get a lot more from an interview when you actually know they had time to think about it, as opposed to nerves got to me, so I didn't come up with an answer, and therefore I don't know if I really got across what I needed to. So the references is where you actually can say, this is what they said, now I need someone to actually verify that.
Very interesting. I love that concept of giving the questions ahead of time. It looks like we're right at 6 o'clock. So thank you so much, Shirley and Jason, for speaking to us today. I know that I've taken away a few points that hopefully I can raise at the next search committee that I'm a part of. And hopefully everybody listening can also bring a few of the points that they've learned today. So we very much appreciate every piece of information that you've given us today and a different perspective on things. So thank you.
No worries. Thank you all for sure.
Thank you.
We're just staying in touch.
And thank you everyone for logging in and listening today.